My name is Yance Ford. I'm director of the documentary film Strong Island, playing in the panorama section of the 2017 Berlinale.
You stumble out of the garage and into the yard, where you fall. You lie on the ground, hole in your chest, another in your lung. You wonder how your family will survive this. You realize that you will not survive this. You can't speak, and no one speaks to you. You do not know that we are silent in our grief, even with one another. You do not know your killer will say he had to shoot you. You do not know your killer will make you out to be a monster. You do not realize that there will be no trial. You don't know that 23 white people will decide no crime has even been committed.
William turned and was shot.
That was the beginning.
Welcome, Yance Ford, director of Strong Island.
Thank you for
having
me. I'm
very happy to have you here.
Oh, it's my honor. Really, thank you.
Strong Island is a very personal film about loss and mourning of your brother William that has been killed in a shooting. By this, or like within this story, you just unravel a second story that seemed to me like the story of structural discrimination of Afro-Americans in the United States. Is that right?
Yeah, actually, Strong Island is set in the suburbs of New York City. My parents did in one generation what most black families who left the South during the Great Migration did in two. They moved from the South to the city, and then they moved from the city to the suburbs in a span of about 4, maybe 5 years. And what they found was a sort of typical American dream, right? Big house, big yard, nice neighbors, but there were only 5 places where my parents could purchase a house in 1971-72 when they were looking to buy and move because of an institutional practice in the United States called redlining. Redlining created pockets of neighborhoods where banks would give mortgages to blacks and where real estate agents would sell homes to blacks, but not outside of those areas. So when you see the map on Strong Island, that is the demographic map from when my parents were looking to move. And that sliver, that's labeled Central Islip, is the only section that my parents were able to buy a home in. So if they didn't want to live all the way out here, and they didn't want to live here or here, they essentially could only choose from 2 other places. And that kind of redlining, that kind of segregation, which is based on, you know, the age-old, you know, run for the hills, the blacks were coming, is still very much in place. There are neighborhoods in Long Island that are predominantly white. Long Island is predominantly white. And the pockets now of segregated communities have shifted in demographics. They are predominantly, a lot of young Latino families have come to live in the communities where my parents originally bought homes, but they can only buy homes in certain places. So the practice continues today, though the race of the people who are being discriminated against has shifted. And that practice of redlining goes all the way back to the GI Bill. It goes all the way back to the founding of the modern, what we think of as the modern suburban enclave in the United States. The suburbs were never meant for black people. They were never meant for black people. But the sellers and the developers, mm-hmm. they targeted people who worked for the city of New York because they could find out exactly how much people made, and they calibrated the cost of the house to those salaries so that they could target specific people and have them come out and buy these homes and only discover later that the schools were terrible, the taxes were terrible, and like I say, at one point at the beginning of the film, my parents wound up paying 36 years of combined tuition for their three kids to go through private school. And that kind of burden financially is one that cripples every dream that any young couple has for their life. So it's insidious and it persists today, and it's something that is as old as the country itself.
I mean, it's important, I guess, to let the people know that your brother was killed in 1992. So it's like more than 25 years. It's like 25 years ago, almost.
Yes.
This year.
This April will be the 25th anniversary of his death. 1992.
What I found intriguing that you, in the beginning, declare that you are first not angry. At the same time, you are not willing to accept that someone else is get to say how your brother William was.
Mm-hmm.
So you had clearly the idea that other people, and not his friends and not his family, what knew him very well, were creating an image of how he should be perceived.
Sure. My brother became, well, first of all, I guess the irony and the sarcasm in my voice and on my face doesn't quite translate as well as I had hoped, because that statement about not being angry was true in the moment. Mm-hmm. But you know, in the overall scheme of things, am I angry that my brother was, you know, turned into the prime suspect and essentially blamed for his own death? Absolutely. Am I angry that his death had a ripple effect on my family? Absolutely. Am I angry that 25 years later, the same type of self-defense justified killings of black men and other people in the United States continue to go unpunished? Absolutely. I'm very angry about that. But when I talk about refusing to allow other people to say who William was, it's because his character, right, was simply reduced to his behavior on one night of his life. And that one night, certainly he was behaving badly, but he also made a fool of himself, right? He picks up a vacuum cleaner to throw it, but before he throws it, he's doused in filthy garage repair water. You know, he picks up a car door, and instead of throwing it, he puts it down because the young woman who owns the car asks him not to throw it. So there's a garage full of people laughing at both parties, mm-hmm. and somehow this is the event that put mortal fear into the heart of the man who killed him. My question then is, well, if you're so afraid for your life in February, why don't you call the police? And why is it that the third interaction that he has with you is the interaction that where you take his life, right? So my brother became larger than life. He was portrayed as muscular and constantly going to the gym. The word intimidating is used over and over and over and over again to describe William. And you would think, based on the way that he's spoken about, that he's a giant. The truth is that he was short. He was 5'8" tall. And the coroner describes him as obese. And you can see that he's got quite a bowl full of jelly in, you know, the Polaroids of, you know, my sister and William and I, when he came up to visit me with my family at university, which was a year before he was killed. He was so overweight, in fact, that he had been disqualified for a job in law enforcement, and because he wanted that job so badly, he starved himself for 32 days to lose the weight so that he could be, you know, marked as qualified. So when I say that I refuse to let someone else say who William was, it's not that I want to paint William as a perfect person. He certainly wasn't. He was flawed, right? He was searching. He was essentially human. And it's the fact that I think Mark Riley and the police department did not see my brother as human that allowed him to get away with this crime. And I think that that lack of humanity is something that is still applied to black people in the United States today. It's easy to take the life of a black person in the United States and not to be punished for it. And it was happening in 1992. That's the thing, right? And one of the important things about the film is that to show this kind of thing was happening before the internet, before social media. Mm-hmm. It happened in isolation. There was 2,000 words printed in the local paper. There was barely a report on the local news. They didn't even archive the entire newscast. They archived maybe 20 seconds, maybe less, of the B-roll. So this, people in our neighborhood and the pastor at the church went around and collected signatures for on a petition that were mailed to the DA. But, you know, in that kind of isolation, without the ability to elevate my brother's case to national attention, that's why it was able to work so well. Because, you know, the forces who were in charge of investigating the case knew that there was no cavalry coming.
It's just the opposite of what happened. Like, I mean, the last few years we had like so much like about hate and murder of like Afro-Americans in multiple American states. Yeah. And I mean, by social media, this kind of events like spread immediately. I mean, you see like even online videos of like this like crime scenes. Yeah. So there's a bigger, I mean, people just like recognize it more easy. Yeah. But at the same time, I mean, does this something change? I mean, this like actual like, that it's all over, that it's spread so easily and people like recognize all this, what's happening.
Right. I think that people are able to connect with each other. And in communities where this has always happened, now people are able to join together. And I think that the Black Lives Matter movement grew directly out of people's ability to connect and almost instantaneously around these deaths, right? So that it was no longer, your husband or your ex-husband gets shot in the back because he's afraid that he owes, you know, back child support, and you see a cop drop a taser on the ground and then concoct a story about, you know, being fearful of his life because the guy grabbed a taser. You can see on the videotape that that's not true, but those people, that family, can instantly plug into a network of people who are going to gather around them and support them. And so for me, it's not so much that the number of killings have increased. It's just that, you know, the people are able to bring them to the fore and publicize them and not allow them to fester in silence and isolation and, you know, and let the injustice go without challenge, which is, my parents tried. My parents did the best that they could. But at a certain point, when the FBI says, no, we're not going to investigate this case as a violation of your son's civil rights, when the governor does not return a letter that you've written, and when none of your pleas to the local politicians who are supposed to represent you go answered, or when they choose not to, escalate their involvement in the case, you know, they had no place to go. But the interesting thing, so The ability to network and to organize, that's changed. But what's interesting is that the explanation for all of these killings have not. The explanation for all of these killings has always been, I feared for my life, right? And so one of the questions that the film asks is, it's not rhetorical. When I ask directly to the camera, what is the distance of reasonable fear?
Towards the end of the film, yeah.
Towards the end of the film, that is a direct challenge to every single person who has said, I killed, fill in the blank, because I was afraid. And my question is, afraid of what? If you, for example, are Renisha McBride, and you may or may not have been out partying with your friends, and you may or may not have, you know, smoked a joint, right? And you knock on somebody's door in the middle of the night, and that person shoots you with a shotgun through a closed door, and then claims to have done so because he was afraid someone was trying to break into his house. That fear is so preposterous. And in that case, that man was actually sentenced to a very long prison term. And in fact, I think he might have been sentenced to life in prison. But with all of the other cases, you know, like, I was afraid. Well, if you were afraid, why did you approach? If you were afraid, why didn't you call, you know, the police? If you were afraid, why didn't you stay inside your house? If you were afraid, why did you come out of the garage? My brother didn't know you were there. Mm-hmm. If you were afraid, why didn't you hide in the bathroom? Why didn't you pick up the phone and call the police? This is the guy who scared you to death in February, back at your place of work in April, not having a conversation with you. And you claim to be afraid of him. Why then are you making yourself known?
So finally, it's like all reduced to the matter of fact that somebody was black, right?
Yes. At the end of the day, if you dissected the fear that is ascribed as the motive, as thoroughly as you dissect the life of the person who was dead, there is no other explanation for the shooting other than race. Mm-hmm. And that is the thing that does not happen. No one ever asks, well, if you were afraid, why this? If you were afraid, why that? If you were afraid, why not the other thing? It's simply, I was afraid. And I think that fear is legitimate. I do not think that fear, it's almost like the rap song, Fear of a Black Planet. You know, it's just like, and anything black, you know, is to be feared. As if our bodies have been weaponized somehow and are just waiting to be deployed to somehow do you in.
I just like you to add another line, because like you made it so well, like aesthetically. Mm. The screen is black while you ask this question. What, exactly. About like fear. How does your fear look?
Yeah.
So, I mean, this is very well done, and
Thank you.
It down to the point, you bring it down to the color in a way too.
Exactly.
So maybe it's a good point to talk about aesthetics of your film, because
sure.
I think it's shot in a very aesthetic way. So the images, for example, from the closed garage door, mm-hmm. the interior of your family home, like mm-hmm. with the curtains, for
sure.
example. And what we spoke about earlier already on, you had like in the film a map of Central Islip, the neighborhood where you lived in,
yeah.
this red lines,
yeah. yeah.
like neighborhood.
Yeah.
And in the end, when you just like talk about the file from the police, you show, for example, a body map, and then you explain on what kind of points your brother was shot.
Right.
So I think like there's a connection.
Interesting. That's very interesting. I hadn't actually made the connection between the two. I hadn't actually made the connection between the two as maps. Map of the body and the map of where the murder took place, but I think that you make a very good point, because the autopsy, it's sort of a form,
mm-hmm.
you know, that all coroner's offices use. And so, you know, the body in the film is very much a thing that is a character, right? So the film is about the corporeal experience of being shot, and we, you know, we understand that by the bits of the autopsy report that I read, right? And it's also about the geography of place and location and how those two things together result in this murder. It's also, I think, by using the autopsy report and by having a very, very minimalist map, right? It we wanted to give you the most important information, right? The map, the most important information are the five places where my parents could have purchased a home.
Mm-hmm.
The autopsy, the most important thing is the body, period. And then you hear the specificity of my brother's wounds, and you slowly are able to understand that in order to get the heart, in order to get to that line about the heart being unremarkable, you understand that an autopsy is a dissection of a human body, right? And so just in the same ways that we dissected segregation and its function in the suburbs, we allow for the dissection of William, you know, as part of the mechanism in which the state pulls your body into its system.
Definitely. I mean, it's also linked by to fear, what you just spoke before already. Like, I mean, why do people fear, like, certain, like, races, for example? Because they are segregated, right? I mean,
there's,
like, no way around. You can't, I mean, you are just, like, designed by, like, authorities where you could live, how you just, like, what kind of schools you may attend. This, like, designs actually the outcome of your whole life. I mean, it's...
Exactly. I think that it's, I think one of the important things to remember is that the United States was founded on violence, and the genocide of indigenous Americans, and it was built in large part by slave labor. And so Africans who came to the United States were never seen as human. And that Africans who came to the Americas were never seen as human. And that has persisted and morphed over time into white supremacy, right? So it's a set of glasses that you have on. And one of the things that, that Strong Island is trying to do, one of the challenges that Strong Island poses to the audience in revealing my brother's face, for example, as we do, is to ask you to change your glasses, right? There are people in the audience who see my brother who are not afraid of him. And they actually see somebody they know and love. They see, you know, their boyfriend, they see their cousin, they see their own brother, they see their own child. And there are some people in the audience who are sitting there and listening to me ask these questions, first in darkness, and then as he begins to emerge. And I hope are wrestling with their own assumptions, because it is a process of instantaneously, you know, sort of like labeling and projecting what you see through your glasses onto that image. And the challenge of the film is to get you to see it differently, to change your glasses, because that's where the fear is. What you're seeing does not exist. You know, like crime in the United States is at historical lows. Yet there is this phantom menace known as black people who are just, you know, well, actually not just black people, immigrants, you know, people from Muslim nations. You know, there is this phantom menace.
Oh, even queer people.
And queer people, exactly. Right? So now, you know, I've been with my partner for 21 years, and I've never been gender conforming. You know, when I was 19 and you see me shave my head, I've never conformed to my birth gender. I've always needed a bathroom buddy, right? I've always needed, people have been attempting to police my body for most of my adult life. My mother though she was well-intentioned. Mm-hmm. You can see from the footage from my Sweet 16 party that I am profoundly uncomfortable in this female role,
yeah.
Right? Well, but it's what your parents expect, right? And I'm also deeply, deeply, you know, like, invested in not coming out to them when I'm 16. Even though at 16 I know that I don't want to be doing this.
But it's also like, I think, like, for me at least, it was like this, like, that you think you need to fit in this kind of category, no? It's like, I mean,
I think it was less about fitting into the category and more about disappointing my parents.
Okay.
You know, like, my mother was so invested in my having a Sweet 16 party. She was so invested in, you know, she was so invested in having a Sweet 16 party for me. She was so invested in, you know, braiding our hair and putting us in little outfits. And I mean, half of the pictures that you see in the movie, my sister and I are dressed up, and it's like, wow, these guys really had, like, like, William is sitting over here in, like, jeans and like loafers, and Yancy and Lauren are in, like, halter tops with barrettes and stuff, and it's like patent leather shoes, and it's 100 degrees outside. You know, the policing of gender in my life began very early. And that's why when I got to college, I was just like, I am, just forget it. Like, just forget it. I mean, one of the most hilarious things about the film that actually didn't make it is that I went to my brother's funeral in a dress that I put on backward. And I didn't realize that I had put it on backward until I felt the tag at my throat. And I was like, oh my God, it's backward. And so, you know, the queer menace, right? The kids who are going to get attacked in the bathroom because, you know, the transgender bill that President Obama had moving through the Justice Department has been squashed by the Trump administration. So where are transgender kids going to go where they can be safe? When are random people at airports all over the United States, when are they going to stop telling me that I'm in the wrong restroom? Like, strangers. And it used to be that I would make a self-effacing joke about, you know, like, no, actually, it's just the haircut. I'm not in the wrong bathroom. And then I got to a point where I was like, you know what? Why am I making fun of myself? Fuck you for thinking that you can tell me where to be. And my response changed to, I can read. Thank you. And I would go about my business. But, you know, I'm 4 months into hormone therapy, and 4 months from now, I may or may not still need a bathroom buddy, depending on what kind of facilities are available. So, the queer menace, you know, it's like, how long have we been talking about the queer menace? And when are we going to just fucking, like, just stop? You know, like, just, like, when are we just going to fucking stop? Like, you've got to have, I feel like Americans have to have something to fear in order to justify the violence of our culture. And that justification and that violence is so pervasive and so, like, exportable, right? And I can't think of anything more dangerous right now than the fear that Americans are so gripped by. And it's like, you have nothing to be, like, nothing to fear from me. I just have to go to the bathroom. You know? It's just, it baffles my mind. And it defies logic. And it's what makes you think, it's what makes you realize that none of it is logical. It's all emotional. It's all fear-based. And until we challenge that fear, until people challenge themselves to see me, to see you, I'm going to have a bathroom buddy for a very long time.
We are running out of time, unfortunately. I could continue to talk longer there was, like, one very fascinating scene when you talk about the phone call you got once from your brother when he got into the situation in the garage a month before he was actually killed.
Yeah.
And I had the idea it was, like, about trust. of your brother towards you. And I had the idea, because like you were talking about queerness, and I had the idea that this was somehow linked to you and to your story, your queer story, like, that you couldn't deal this like secret with him, and that you felt like bad about it in the end.
In the end, and you know, these are realizations that come along with actually making the film. In the end, I wish I had trusted my brother sooner, with, you know, and had come out to him in my freshman year, because he, you know, written me a letter. He wrote me letters when I was away. I'm like, how's the guy seen? If you caught anybody giving you the hi there look, and then he would explain this really awkward look that straight guys, you know, get caught in when they're like trying to come up with something for you, like to say to you, but they can't, and so they just sort of say hi there, you know. And so I could have written back. I could have written to him in that letter. I could have said, actually, well, can you know, like, can we talk? You know, on this day, because I got your letter and there's something I want to talk to you about. But I wasn't quite there yet. I was still in that place where I think a lot of people who are queer land, which is being afraid of losing what you love the most by coming out, right? But when he called me and had this, like, you know, like, guy talk, right? Like, it literally, it was like guy talk, and it was so wonderful. And I was like, yes, my brother is calling me and talking to me about defending our mother's honor. That call was so wonderful. That call was such a light for me in our relationship that I wanted to keep it to myself. You know, I wanted to keep it to myself, and that it was the thing that I now second guess, even, you know, in the middle of the night, to this day, it's such a painful yet joyful thing, and to have both of those things live in that single phone call. That phone call was such a painful and a joyful thing, that to have both of them live in a single call, and that one experience is still something that I struggle with today. I ultimately think that my brother should not have been shot, period, even if he had been there. But that phone call is really special to me. And it will remain something that I deal with and process for the rest of my life.
And that's why I'm so grateful that you shared to the viewers, to me.
Thank you.
Yance Ford, thank you so much for coming.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me. It's been a real pleasure.